So first of all, I'd like to thank the organizers and especially Ajith for having me here. And congratulations, Bala. So 2 years ago, when I gave a summer school course for grad students here, it was very humbling to see Bala come every day before me ahead of time and sit through the class entirely. So I hope that when I reach that age, I will have the same passion. Okay, so let's begin. So all these beautiful detections that Sathya mentioned, in his talk, so they are enabled by a very detailed search. And at the lowest level, the search consists of looking for a number of templates in the data. So this is the space of templates that was used in one of the LIGO searches, the GST-LAL search during the O2 run, in the space of the component masses, so M1 and M2. And the colors indicate the family of the merger. So the green is the binary neutron stars. These are the neutron star black holes. And this is the binary black hole part. And the search procedure consists of running all these templates over the data and getting these background distributions that Sathya showed. And so this is not quite the same thing that was shown, but this is the number as a function of the false alarm rate. And then you set a particular threshold in terms of false alarm rate for calling something like a candidate, which is was decided to be, I'm not in LIGO, but this decided to be 1 in 30 days, something that happens 1 in 30 days over the entire bank. And the second thing is that since you have a significant number of events that you have already seen, you have some idea about the population of the events. So you have a so-called quantity, which is P astro, which roughly quantifies the chance that it comes from the same population. So with these two criteria, so the threshold on P astro was set to 1/2, and the along with the threshold on the false alarm rate. And with these criteria, LIGO worker found these events that were in this catalog that Sathya presented. So at this point, we were a group of theorists in Princeton, and since theorists' time is not valuable, we decided to do our own search. So every search you make involves a bunch of decisions. So the first decision we made is that, if you look at the way the templates are, located, spaced on this plane, it's not uniform, right? So there are the per unit mass, the number of the density of templates is much, much higher at lower masses than it is at higher masses. And this is because of the many, many radians of phase that is accumulated here. So formally, if you just imagine, each template having a constant mismatch with respect to the adjacent template and count the part of the astrophysical parameter space that is assigned to one particular template, if you just run all these templates over data and compute it using this procedure, if you view the search procedure as a way of, you start out with ignorance and then you reach some, you get some information about the population of events in the data. Starting out with this corresponds to effectively assuming that each of these templates is equally likely to be produced by a real event, right? So this is an implicit prior on the population of events in the universe. But then you see that the detected events do not follow this, right? And this is because of both selection effects and intrinsic population. But whatever it is, as far as I am concerned as an observer, you see that the observed events do not follow the distribution of the template. So this means that your initial prior is not what, the real events follow. So, but you're not allowed to look at this before you make your search, but then you can start with the best astrophysical knowledge you have. So the first thing is that if these mergers were formed from the stars, we know that the stars or the black holes were formed in star after the evolution of stars. Stars follow an initial mass function. So the simplest form is the so-called Saul-Peter mass function, which dn dm goes as m to the minus 2.35. And the second thing is the selection effect that Sathya mentioned, which is that as you go to higher chirp masses, signal is louder, so you see more of the universe. You can see it across more of the universe. So So these two effects, they nearly cancel. So there are more of these at low masses, but they are fainter. So it turns out that to zeroth approximation, it's a good, it's a good starting point to assume that before you ever start the search process, the mergers would be distributed log flat in masses. So motivated by that, what we did was we divided this search. Let's focus on just the binary black holes because that's what is the point of my talk. So we divided the search into five banks, each of which was a factor of two in chirp mass. So, and if you think of each of them as a search and give yourself a trials factor at the end, it corresponds to roughly saying that the mergers occur log flat in terms of the mass, right? So that's just the simple part, which is the template bank. And then any search has to deal with systematics in the data. And as we learned more about the data, we came up with methods to deal with it. So the first and one of the most important systematics is that the underlying assumption of the matched filter, which is that the data is given is a Gaussian random process in the absence of signals, turns out to be false. And so this is showing, so if indeed the data is a Gaussian random process, then you can compute a score and as a function of time for a given template, and this score should be distributed as a unit normal variable. And this is showing the histogram of the variance estimated empirically on the data for one particular template. So the overlaps for Hanford and Livingston, and the measurement noise is such that you would have only 1% dispersion here. But in reality, you see that there can be 10% excursions, which is telling you that the data is non-stationary at the level of 10%, right? So this is the first thing that we corrected for. So we computed a way that, so the loss of volume because of this is around 30%. So we compute, came up with a method to get back this, most of this 30% and get you back to a few percent level, which we call the PST drift correction. The second thing is that, so this is, something which is very subtle, but there are some very nasty things, like the most famous example of which is, so these are called glitches. The most famous example of which is, so in the binary neutron star in the stronger detector, Livingston, and there is a huge glitch just before the merger, right? And these things, if it happened then, it tells you it happens all the time, right? And if you don't account for them, they will pollute your background and make you lose volume, and we don't like losing volume. So we borrowed a technique from the CMB literature, which where you try to measure the power spectrum of the CMB and you have a point source which you want to mask out, and there is a way to mask it out without losing your without biasing your measurement of the long modes. So this effectively amounts to solving a linear algebra problem. So we identify these glitches and automatically solve this linear algebra problem, inpaint the data, and in this way we don't lose matched filtering signal to noise ratio where there is no glitch. And finally, so this we can only do for the loudest glitches, and for the fainter ones we have to have vetoes. And so one of the things that LIGO does, and we also do, is we effectively do a in-spiral merger ring down consistency test for every trigger. We check that when something jumps, all it has all the parts of the merger is happening in the data. So if if GR is completely wrong and all the calculations are wrong, sorry. Right? So we in this way we reject background. And the effect of all this, of all these, ways of dealing with the systematics, is that you go from this initial distribution to the green distribution, and you can quantify that. These are the individual changes due to each of them. And the green distribution is actually, apart from the triggers here, which are events, it's actually very well fit by a chi-square distribution with a few degrees of freedom. So we are trying, so our aim is to always get to the Gaussian level because we know how to do that, right? So, and this different systematics are more or less important depending on the length of the waveform, which is effectively the mass. And so this is the, these are coincident triggers between the two detectors, and this is just a single detector histogram for the O1 data, and this is 150914, and you can see the level of background rejection, and these are all the LVC injections that are present in the data, and we keep all of them in, so we are safe to, you know, losing real events. And so if we go back to the old plot, these are the LVC events that were shown in the first plot, and we have six new events in O2 and one new event in O1. I'll describe them. So in O1, so this is, by the way, the background distribution without accounting for the coherent phase between the two detectors in the bank, in what we call bank 2, which is triggers with chirp mass between 6 and 12 solar masses. So this contains the so-called LVT trigger, which was later GW15, 10, 12. And you can see that even without imposing phase coincidence, we have we can declare this event with a really, really good false alarm rate. Actually, it's enough. I'm not in the business of comparing, but whatever. And then so this resulting improvement in the background uncovered a new trigger which was above the bar defined by the LVC for calling something an event. So that's what we call 15, 12, 16. So this has a false alarm rate of once in 6 years in its own bank, and if you give it a trials factor, it's roughly once in a year. And the probability of being astrophysical is 70%, so the bar that LIGO set is 50%. So for reference, 170729, which was the heaviest trigger in O2, one of the pipelines in LIGO had a false alarm rate, had a P astro of 52%. So this is at, you know, it's not unheard of that, you know, we have these things. And when you're doing a search, you have to be responsible and report everything you find. And so these are the omega scans of the event in O1. And in O2, so these dots, these blue dots are the events that the LVC found and reported in their catalog. And because of our background rejection, we get these yellow, in these additional yellow dots. And by the false alarm rates assigned to the same event by both pipelines, we can quantify the improvement in volume roughly. And we measure roughly a factor of 2. So this is the limit volume that we can say in terms of V over V max, where V max is some, you know, idealized thing. And this is in the same units, the limit volume defined by the detection cut for LVC, right? And these are the new, these are the yellow dots that came out. And you know, so several of them are like, you know, we can only place upper bounds on, you know, they're like really significant in the search. And some of them are less significant, but that's life. So these are the omega scans or the spectrograms of the six new events that we found in O2 above the detection thresholds. And these are the parameters. So this is in the space of detector frame chirp mass and the so-called effective spin parameter. And the blue posteriors are those of the events in the LIGO catalog. And the other ones are the ones that we report, and with a range of P astro. So, you know, so these are the ones for which our confidence in them is similar to what, you know, GW170729 is. And the most interesting one, so this is the same thing in the space of the source frame masses. So the most interesting one, I would say, is this one, which was found in O1, the, you know, the trigger in O1. So in general, these are the parameters of all the events. And before we get to the one in O1, the interesting thing is one of the most significant event in O2, it has an effective spin parameter which is bounded away from zero at the 95.8% confidence interval. And a couple of the triggers have redshifts, which inferred redshifts, which are, you know, which go out beyond 0.6. So, you know, it's consistent with improving the detection volume that you see fainter and fainter things. So this is the less significant one. Yeah, the P astro is 52%. It's what it is. The interesting thing for this thing is that this is the posteriors of this event in the space of the detector frame chirp mass and the effective spin parameter and the mass ratio. So the effective spin parameter is strongly bounded away from zero, and it actually depends on the prior that you use to compute it. So the prior where each of the spins comes is drawn randomly on the unit sphere gives it it has a strong peak in terms of this effective spin parameter because there's not much volume for it to be aligned. So if you use that prior, the best fit value is 0.6 or so, and if you use some formally agnostic prior on the value of chi effective, so you try to make it flat because this is what the waveform actually depends on, it goes to around 0.8. And we find no evidence for precession. We tried looking for that. And so the interesting thing about this event is if you look at it in the space of chi effective and Q, so these are the posteriors of the LVC events, and the black one is this one. And so if you have a model of the source as coming from in a globular cluster with two random spins, and it turns out that the best only way to reconcile this is if you have mass ratio of two, which happens if you are a second generation merger. So then this would follow this line, and it's not really consistent with that. While these two lines are, it's tidally locked in the field scenario, and so one is if the lighter ones forms last, and one is if the heavier one forms last, and that's as far as the events go. So I don't know if I have time to get into the scenarios. Okay, how long? It says zero. Okay. So there are a whole forest of scenarios for the formation of binary black holes that have been proposed in the literature. This is probably a non-exhaustive list. And so if you go through them and you can try to organize them in some ways. So there are two classes. One is where there are lots of binary black holes, but the efficiency with which they merge is low. So these are field binaries which either get together because of common envelope evolution or exotic effects due to rotation. And then triple systems, so with hierarchical companion that drives the inner one to merger, or primordial black holes. And the other ones are systems where they form a very small fraction of the population of stars, but they are super efficient at forming mergers. So it could be either one of these, and as of now, I would say no one really knows, right? So then the second family is things that use ingredients that we know. So population 3 stars and primordial black holes are interesting ideas, but we don't have independent proof of their existence yet. And finally, there are scenarios which require only gravity to operate to get them together, and some which require electromagnetic intervention of some sort. So it's up to your taste. As of now, I would say which one is responsible. But the interesting thing is that many of them have post-dict similar rates. So clearly, it's not all compatible with nature, but there are many fudge parameters in these estimates, and nature need not realize binary black holes only one way. So there are not only one kind of stars in the sky. So we it's more creative than the theorists. So we should keep an open mind. So the rates which are inferred from the LVC population. So there are various ways of fitting for the rates, but in general, it's not a matter of simply counting because of the selection effects, but basically the posteriors are thinnest where there are most of the events there, and it's not true that that every channel has to explain the overall merger rate, because if for example your scenario has all black holes of only one kind, it might be responsible for mergers in one part of this parameter space. So all I'm saying is it's a bit preliminary to say that something is ruled out. But we are looking forward with interest to what more detections tell us. And so here are some caveats to saying that anything rules out one particular channel, because everything you can think of that isolated binaries need to have aligned spins. There are caveats to that because of kicks and because of the efficiency of tidal alignment. If you want to say triples have randomly oriented spins in terms of the inner binary, again, that need not be true because of the way the LK mechanism works. And if you want to say field binaries have no eccentricity when they form in the LIGO band, that need not be true either. So we should keep an open mind and wait for more events. And I'll skip the lensing part because I wanted to get to something which was just more like in terms of not showing a result of a paper, but just like some thoughts. So, like my very good friend Varun, I interacting with him, I have come to appreciate what observers think like. So they like thinking in terms of parameter space. And so say here, for example, this is a classic plot in transients where they say there's a characteristic time scale and there's a peak luminosity and you divvy up chunks and say, I'm going to observe this, or this might be something interesting and this is unexplored. So rather than the more sophisticated way of doing Bayesian estimation for the rate, sometimes there is value in also thinking about it this way. So analogy I would like to make in a longer term thing is, so this is the famous PP dot diagram for pulsars. So this is plotting the period derivative versus the period. So in this plane, so pulsars are, so P dot over P is 1/h. So contours of constant age are, go this way, and contours of constant magnetic field go this way, P times P dot. And the idea is that a pulsar is born here and then moves along this line slowly. And then the observed distribution of pulsars is the result of the motion of all these things after they were born in this plane. And then you have some weird outliers here, which are these millisecond pulsars, which are supposed to be in binaries, right? So if you cast your mind, 50 years in the future and ask, if I make a PP dot diagram for gravitational wave sources, what will they look like? So this is like a really bad diagram I made. So this is frequency and this is F dot. So these are the events that were detected in the O1 and O2 runs by LIGO. So events, which are driven just by gravitational wave merger, move along contours of constant chirp mass. And F over F dot is analogous to age here. So you can imagine that as time moves forward, events move along this line until they merge, right? So if we had access to this complete plane, we would see, for a brief moment, because this is very short in the LIGO band, we would see this flicker here and die. And way down here, this is the population of verification binaries that Lisa, is planning to see. And these are the binary pulsars. So they are not, and if you have a 5-year baseline, you can convert that into, if you think of it like a radio experiment, you can think of it as if you have a baseline on time, you get a error, you get a sensitivity on F dot. So this is the F dot, minimum F dot that Lisa will be able to detect for over five years. So it will be able to see a bunch of the verification binaries. But it would be very boring if this is what it is in nature. So this is the Lisa band for reference, and this is the LIGO band, and this is the unknown intermediate band that Rana was talking about. So we, as of now, if we had Lisa and LIGO, we would see these parts of the plane, and there's this unexplored part here. And if we ask what are the other sources and where do they populate this plane? So these are the supermassive black holes. They live here and die here. But then these are not the only sources in the gravitational wave sky. There would be these interesting binaries here, which evolve in the opposite direction because of mass transfer. So these would be systems undergoing mass transfer, which elongates, which makes the semi-major axis longer. So they would not move along contours of constant chirp mass, but they would move in some other way. So if we stared at this system for a long time, we would see a bunch of things moving this way and some things moving this way, right? And then there's this unexplored band here, which is, you know, where did these come from? They came from here, right? And so this is like, flow along a pipe. So rho times V is constant. So most of the stuff would be, stuck here if you take a snapshot at a given time. So there would be all of these things, their past, the past of the things that you see in LIGO is here. And, who knows where they are born? I don't know, right? Maybe they are born somewhere here and we would see them pop up. And, maybe you'll see eccentricity and they don't actually move this way. Maybe you'll see lensing and you'll see them not move along this contour, but you'll see them move along some, weird path. It's a wonderful world out there, and who knows what we will see.
Thank you.